Razer mice plus a Windows machine can give you admin privileges, contact tracing, data is exposed in a data leak, and a T-Mobile hack follow-up. Yes, it is real. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for August 24th, 2021. This is your weekly summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. Also, happy pumpkin spice latte day, if you're into that like I am. Definitely getting Starbucks after this. We have some hacks and some zero days to get into, so on to the news. Now, props to Joel for sharing this story. Microsoft is currently investigating a newly discovered bug that could let a person plug in a peripheral and gain admin rights. Yes, that is the bug. It's a zero day found in the device installer software for Razer mice and keyboards and any other peripherals that use the Razer Synapse utility. It's possible this could affect Windows 11 too, so we may see updates as that OS is tested. If you hear any noise in the background, it's probably because my dog is down here. So Razer manufactures popular gaming peripherals like headsets, mice, and keyboards, and Synapse allows for you to change lighting patterns, macros, and other configurations. Now, while this bug was not disclosed through a private communication, Razer did award a bug bounty to the original security researcher who found the issue. John Hatt on Twitter had posted a tweet about the bug on Saturday after he tried to contact Razer and he got no reply, but the tweet did get their attention. According to his tweet, if you have physical access, you could plug in a Razer dongle or a mouse. Windows Update will download and execute Razer installer.exe as system, and you can hit shift and right click at the same time to abuse the elevated explorer and open PowerShell. More so, he added that quote, if you go through the installation process and define the saved directory to a user controllable path like desktop, a service binary is saved there, which could be hijacked for persistence and is executed before user logon on boot. Now, since the Razer installer executable launches via a Windows process with system privileges and it keeps those same admin privileges, you can change the default installation folder, and at that point, you hit shift and right click to open PowerShell with the same privileges as well. That PowerShell prompt allows you to open PowerShell window here, it's one of the options, and that can open PowerShell from the folder directory with the same elevated privileges. Now again, this does require physical access, but it can just take a minute or two to implement. And knowing how many different gaming mice I have tested for my own tech channel, I immediately wondered if I could do this with other brands too, given that all of them have similar installation patterns and they prompt you to install their software. And other commenters on John Hatt's tweet are starting to share the same hypothesis, with one saying that it works on Republic of Gamers peripherals too. It's entirely possible that this does not just affect Razer. Now, this is a really easy one to test, so if you have a computer where you can legally do so, I would love to know if it works with other brands of peripherals as well. Security research firm UpGuard discovered a flaw in Microsoft Power Apps portals that was exposing data to the internet. They found about 38 million records were exposed from over 1,000 different web apps that many companies were using, including 750,000 datasets from Indiana's contact tracing system for COVID-19. Unfortunately, Indiana's Department of Health described this as unauthorized access from UpGuard, even though it was a data leak that UpGuard was alerting them to. Microsoft's Power Apps Portal service is a developer platform that allows you to easily create mobile or web apps, and you can spin them up rather quickly. So they are great for setting up a public-facing site and even a data management backend for large companies, government agencies, and even small businesses. Now that this flaw has been fixed, it was originally found back in May by the researchers, we know that several companies were leaving this data exposed, and that includes American Airlines, Ford, Maryland Department of Health, and the New York City Municipal Transportation Authority, New York City Public Schools, and of course, Indiana's Department of Health. Some of these web apps were being used for job application portals, employee databases, vaccination appointment signups, and contact tracing. which means that some of the data exposed is very sensitive, like home addresses, social security numbers, phone numbers, emails, dates of birth, and more. UpGuard found that when spinning up some Power App APIs, they defaulted to leaving data publicly accessible, and you have to manually set up those privacy settings, so many companies and agencies just never did that. Microsoft responded after UpGuard reported the issue to them by changing Power App's portals to default to storing data privately in their API. They also released a tool so users can easily tell if their app is exposing that data. Almost all of the sensitive data is now secure due to UpGuard contacting customers of Power Apps directly to disclose this information before publicizing this news to media outlets. I love it when y'all send me these adorable pictures of your pets. So these are a few from my Hush Puppy Patreon Alliance members. And also a big thank you to Christy and Jose for joining. Patreons are starting to receive their new merch rewards in the mail, like mugs and stickers, depending on your perk level. Big shout out to Brian as well for this mugshot. Great picture. You can always sign up at any time to get access to those perks. Patreon.com/ThreatWire, as always, is the reason why this show exists. So thank you so much, and on to the third news story. Now, last week I shared news about a potential T-Mobile hack that was yet to be confirmed by the carrier. The day after recording that, T-Mobile did confirm the hack, and they gave us some more information about what is going on and what was stolen. So if you want to check out the original story and get all the details about how that happened, it's a part of my Bitcoin cryptocurrency video, which happened last week on the Hack 5 channel. It's also available on my video podcast feed as well. So this is what we know from T-Mobile's disclosure. This hack affects 7.8 million current customers with data like first and last names, date of birth, social security numbers, and driver's license or ID information being compromised. Phone numbers and the IMEI and IMSI numbers were also compromised. Another 5.3 million postpaid customer accounts had one or more of those mentioned data points accessed as well. No SSNs or driver's license info was compromised for those 5.3 million. Now, along with this, another 40 million former or prospective customers' data was exposed. That includes names, date of birth, SSN and driver's licenses, and another 667,000 former customers had data accessed as well, including names, phone numbers, addresses, and date of birth. Now, furthermore, they also found that separate data points like phone numbers, IMEI, and IMSI numbers were stolen, but with no identifiable information tied to them. No payment information, including credit card or financial info, was exposed. And then there's also another 850,000 active prepaid customers who also had their data exposed, including names, phone numbers, and account PINs. T-Mobile is offering affected customers 2 years of ID theft protection, and they recommend customers sign up for Scam Shield as well as reset PINs and passwords. I will also add to that, be very aware of the threat of SIM swapping and take all steps that you can to protect your phone number from being ported to a new phone. They have also closed off the back door that was used by a malicious actor to steal the data, and the hack is under an active investigation by authorities. All right, so now that the studio is finished down here, yay, I'm back to filming content over at youtube.com/ShannonMorse. Hit that subscribe button on that channel to see my upcoming review of the Pixel 5a 5G from Google. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to this channel as well. I'm Shannon Morse, and I will see you on the internet